This session covers distributed computing system models. So when we design a new distributed system, it is based on some model, right? And these models are called distributed computing system models. And these models are broadly classified into 5 different categories. Those are mini computer model, workstation model, workstation server model, processor pool model, and a combination of these base models that is called hybrid model. So let us see one by one. First of all, the basic model is called the mini computer model. Actually, this mini computer model is an extension of our centralized time sharing system. You can see like this, we have a set of mini computers which are interconnected using a communication network. And this mini computer may be a supercomputer also, okay? So all these computers are connected, and on each mini computer, in this case or any supercomputer, a set of users will be connected using different terminals. Each user will be logged into a particular mini computer using that terminal, and at the same time he or she will be allowed to access the remote mini computer through the network. So this type of models are usually used for resource sharing, like databases and all, which are there in the remote computer. And earlier, ARPANET is an example for mini computer model. Now coming to the second model, that is workstation model, as shown in the figure, a set of workstations are interconnected using a communication network. So here, what's the idea behind this type of model is that a company's office or a university department may have several workstations scattered throughout a building or campus, right? And each workstation will be equipped with its own desk and computing power, and normally it is designed as a single user computer. And it is often found that in such an environment, at any point of time, a significant proportion of the workstations are idle, that is, they are not being used. And this will result in the waste of large amount of CPU time. So the idea behind the workstation model is to interconnect all these workstations together within a campus by using a high-speed LAN, so that idle workstations can be used to execute some jobs or processes of the users which are logged into some other workstations. Okay. And these users don't have enough computing power here, so some of the jobs from this workstations can be moved into this workstation, and that will be executed there. So in this model, a user logs onto one workstation, and that can be called as his home workstation, and submit all the jobs here. And when the system finds that the user's workstation does not have sufficient processing power, it will just transfer one or more processes from this workstation to some remote workstation which are currently idle, and gets the process executed there, and finally the result will be sent back to the user's workstation. So obviously this model is not simple to implement, right? Because lot of issues are there. We can see what are the different issues. First of all, how to find an idle workstation, that is the first issue. Then how the processes can be transferred from one workstation and to get it executed in another workstation, that is process migration, how it can be done. And the third issue is what happens if to the remote process if a user logs on to the remote machine once we assign the jobs to the. So those are the main issues we have to face. First two issues, that is finding an idle workstation and process migration. These two topics will be discussed later. And coming to the third issue, that is we have assigned some of our processes to some other remote idle workstations. After this assignment, some users logged on to that remote machine. What happens to our processes, remote processes? That's the question. And different approaches are there to handle this issue. And first approach is that allow the remote process share the resources of the workstation along with its own lockdown users processes. This method is easy to implement, but it defeats the main idea of workstation serving as personal computers. Because if remote processes are allowed to execute simultaneously with the lockdown users processes, the lockdown user does not get his or her guaranteed response. So that is the issue with this approach. And the second approach is that kill the remote process. So the main drawback of this method are that all the processing done for the remote process gets lost, and the file system may be left in an inconsistent state, making this method unattractive. And the third solution or third approach is that migrate the remote process back to its home workstation so that its execution can be continued there. So this method is somewhat difficult to implement because it requires the system to support preemptive process migration facility. So these are the different approaches for addressing the third issue. Examples for this workstation models are Sprite system and an experimental system developed on Xerox PARC. Now coming to the third model, that is workstation server model. So far we have discussed two different models. Right? In the case of workstation models, each workstation is a use of a personal use, right? It will have a local file system and it's on disk also. Whereas we have another set of workstations which are called diskless workstations without a local disk. And these are merged due to the proliferation of high-speed networks. Now, use of the diskless workstation makes this workstation server model more relevant. Now we can see how it's actually connected. We have a set of workstations connected together with a set of mini computer. Now coming to the third model, that is workstation server model. In case of workstation model, we have a set of workstations, each with its own local file system and local disk. Those workstations can be called as diskful workstations. Anyway, with the emergence of high-speed network, we have another category of workstations called diskless workstations. Those workstations are not having any local disk. So, in the case of workstation server model, we have a set of diskless workstations and set of mini computers. These mini computers act as special servers, just for example, a file server. Another mini computer act as a database server. Like that, we have a special servers. All these are interconnected using a high speed network. This is how the workstation server model is configured. So this diskless workstations act as clients. And normally some specific applications like graphic and interactive application runs in the same workstation. And requests for services, special services like file, print, HTTP, like such requests will be forwarded to the servers and that will be done by the servers. And thus mini computers act as servers here. Each mini computer is dedicated to one or more different types of services like file server, print server, etc. And these clients and servers communicate each other using some remote communication methods like RPC, RMI, etc. So in this model, each user logs on to a particular workstation called his or her home workstation. All the normal computation activities required by the user's processes are performed at the user's home workstation itself. But requests for services provided by special servers such as database server or a print server will be forwarded to corresponding server, and the requested activity will be done by the corresponding server and the result will be sent back to the corresponding user's machine. Therefore, in this model, users' processes need not be migrated to the server machines for getting the work done by those machines. Instead, a request replay service will be there. Let us compare these two models, that is workstation server model and workstation model. Workstation server model is cheaper because we are employing diskless workstations there. It is much cheaper to use a few mini computers equipped with very large and fast disks that are accessed over the network than a large number of disk-full workstations, with each workstation having a small and slow disk. And second, diskless workstations are easier to maintain. It is obvious that backup and hardware maintenance are easier to perform with a few large disks than with many small disks scattered all over a building or campus. And the third one, in case of file servers, user can log in from any system. So in case of workstation server model, all files are managed by the file servers. And users have the flexibility to use any workstation and access the files in the same manner, irrespective of which workstation the user is currently logged on. And process migration is not needed in the case of workstation server model. So here, the request response protocol is used to access services. So unlike the workstation model, this model does not need a process migration facility, which is very difficult to implement also. And finally, a user has guaranteed response time because workstations are not used for executing remote processes. So anyway, this model does not utilize the processing capability of idle workstations. That is a drawback compared to workstation model. Now an example for this type of distributed computing system is vSystem developed by Sherrington. Next one is processor pool model. So this model is based on the observation that most of the time a user does not need any computing power, but once in a while he or she may need a very large amount of computing power for a short time. So unlike the workstation server model, where in the case of workstation server model, a processor is allocated to each user, right? Whereas in the case of processor pool model, the processors are pooled together and that can be shared by users as per need. The pool of processors consists of a large number of mini computers and microcomputers attached to a common network. Each processor in the pool will have its own memory to load and run a system program or an application program. So we can see in the figure that there is no direct terminals attached to this servers. That is, the users interact with this processor pool using a set of terminals connected to the network. And usually these terminals are either diskless workstations or some special devices or graphic terminals like X terminals. And there will be a special server which is called a run server, which will manage, this is a run server which is shown in this figure, which will manage and allocate the processors in the pool to different users on a demand basis. So when a user submits a job for computation, an appropriate number of processors are temporarily assigned to his or her job by the run server. Just for example, if the user's computation job is a compilation of a program having n segments, in which each of the segments can be compiled independently to produce a separate relocatable object file, n different processors from the pool can be allocated to this job to compile all the n segments in parallel. And when the computation is completed, the processors are returned to the pool for the use of other users. So in the case of processor pool model, there is no concept of home machine. That is, the user is not logging into any special machine. Instead, he or she will get into the entire system as a whole. So if we compare this processor pool model with the workstation server model, the processor pool model allows better utilization of available processing power of a distributed computing system. This is because the processor pool model, the entire processing power of the system is available for the use of any currently logged users. Whereas in case of workstation model, that is not the case, right? Several workstations may be idle at a particular time, but they cannot be assigned to any other processing job of other users. But this model is not suitable for high performance interactive applications like graphics and something like that. This mainly because of the slow speed of the terminals to which the user is connected actually. So in such cases, workstation server model is more preferred. And coming to examples, Amoeba, Plan9, Cambridge distributed computer systems are example for
distributed system having a processor pool model.
Now a hybrid model. So out of the four models we have discussed, workstation model is the most widely used model because a large number of computer users only perform simple interactive tasks such as editing, sending electronic mails, etc. So workstation server model is ideal for such simple usage. But in some cases, there can be a group of users who often perform jobs which needs massive computation. So in such cases, processor pool model will be more attractive. So let us combine the advantage of these two models, that is workstation server model and processor pool model, to form a new model that is called hybrid model. The hybrid model is based on the workstation server model but with addition of a pool of processors. So the processors in the pool can be allocated dynamically for computations that are too large for workstations or that require several computers concurrently for efficient execution. So we can enjoy both benefits of both systems. However, the ideal hybrid model is more expensive, which is compared to the workstation model and processor pool model.